Interview of Mr. Robert Reppenhagen, 20 February 2001, Connecticut Street Armory, Buffalo. Interview was Lieutenant Colonel Robert von Hassel. Videographer is Mr. Michael Akey. Mr. Reppenhagen, tell me where you grew up, where you were born.
I was born in Buffalo in 1918, and went to school in Buffalo, and then I went to the University of Buffalo, and I got my degree in history teaching in 1940. But actually, I was an isolationist until we got into the war. And then I registered for the draft, and then I got a 3A deferment. And I was working some part-time jobs, 1940 to 41. And then I got went to Curtis Air for a year, and then in August of 42, I enlisted in the Marines in the officers program at Quantico. So I went on active duty in October, and in December the course was over, and they said that they didn't think that I was the type for a Marine officer, so I went home. And then in April of 1943, I was drafted and went to Fort Niagara, and then was sent to Atlantic City in the Air Force. And from there, they sent me to Fort Monmouth, and they said that I would be a radio operator. So I was at Fort Monmouth for about 5 months in 43, and I became a high-speed radio operator. And then in they shifted us down to Drew Field, Florida, in aircraft warning. And I was there a week or so, and an officer came around. He said they were looking for volunteers for hazardous duty, so I said, yeah, I'd sign up, which I did. And then when I got back to the barracks there, I talked to one of the other fellows, and he said, you know what you're going to do? And I said, no. And he said, you're going to jump out of airplanes. Well, I never thought of that. And I'm afraid of height. I hate to stand on a curb. But I didn't want to back out then. So I said, well, we'll see what happens. So then a couple weeks later, they moved us up to Washington, and I went to the Congressional Country Club with the Office of Strategic Services with General Donovan, and we trained at the Congressional Country Club. Actually, it wasn't quite as nice as it sounds. It wasn't bad, but I mean, you weren't living in a country club. And then we went up to a place called Area B. Area F was the Congressional Country Club, and they had all kinds of odd stuff going on there, and they had a fellow there named Major Fairbairn. He was from the British Army, and he was very famous. He had a lot of books about dirty fighting and all that stuff. He was an expert of that. He had been a policeman in Shanghai. But Area B originally was a CCC camp. And they cut it in half, and half of it they made into a camp for the presidents, and it's now Camp David. And the other half was we trained in weapons, all kinds of weapons, up from pistols up to a bazooka. And then we went back to Area F, and then in the end of March, when they sent us overseas, we were sent to we went to Norfolk, Virginia, and then we went to Casablanca, and we landed there, and then we got on these 40 and 8s and took the train over to Algiers. And we had a camp on the Mediterranean near Algiers. And when we arrived in the camp, there was a bunch came to greet us who had been there already, and they had all kinds of broken arms and legs and bandages. And so I said, what happened to you guys? And they said, well, we just had our jump training. Well, anyway, in a couple of weeks, then we had our jump training in a place called Blida in northern Algeria. They had an airport there, and the OSS had some planes and that. They used to fly people over into Italy and around there and drop supplies and all that jazz. And so then we trained for 2 days on mock-ups and that. And then we had to make 4 jumps. Well, sometimes the wind was bad, so it took us 4 days, but we made 4 jumps. And then they said we had the wings of the American paratroops. So then they said that they had people going into Italy and Greece and the Balkans and all that. And then they shipped us up to England. And we got in England just before the invasion, and they sent us to Brock Hall. It was an estate north of London at Northampton, outside of Northampton. And that was our base there. And they had a bunch of Norwegians there. They were Norwegian-Americans. They were going into Norway. And although first they sent a lot of them into France because they had too much trouble getting into Norway. And then the head of the camp then was Prince Serge Obolensky. He was a colonel. He had been a Russian prince. He was quite a nice fellow. There's been a whole, he had a whole book written about him. And he was sort of an odd character, but very nice. His first wife was a daughter of Tsar Alexander III, and his second wife was one of the Astors. And then I was in what was called the first French group. We were supposed to go into France. And, you know, they had all these different groups. They had Polish and German and a lot of Italian groups, Greek, Balkan. So then they, in a couple of days, they sent us to radio school. They're always sending us to radio school. You had to keep your speed up. And so we went to a British camp in Henley. It was Folly Court. It was a big old estate, and they had all kinds of secret British stuff going on there, I guess SOs and SOEs and all their spies and radio men and all that, code, a lot of code work.
SO being a special operations.
Yeah.
Special operations executive.
Yeah, right, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, they had someone in, you know, two three-man teams, but we were to go in as a group. So we were at Henley, and then all of a sudden they called us back to Brock Hall, and they said we were going to go to a British jump school. So they sent us up to Manchester at the Ringway. So we were to go through the British jump school, which had we had to do 7 jumps. And the first 2 days you trained, you know, and then you jumped out of a balloon. You went up in these big balloons, a tethered balloon, and then you dropped through a hole in the British method. And so we did 2 of those, and then you had to do a night jump, and you had to do a jump with a kit bag where it was strapped to your leg, and then in your air you had to let it down and it hit the ground, and then you pulled it in and that. So we made the 7 jumps, and then I got the wings of the British paratroops. And then we went back to Henley for a short time, and then they said we were going into France. So what it was, the mission we were to go on, in World War I, they used the harbor at Brest. That was their big harbor to ship everything in. So they figured they'd use it in World War II. And right near Brest, there was a railroad bridge. And they were afraid that when the American army came in, that the Germans would blow the bridge. So they said we should go in and hold the bridge until the army got there. So that was supposed to be a big operation. We had the Colonel Obolensky and our captain and the whole group. There was about 35 of us in 3 planes. So in early August, we got ready to go. And what happened was the first plane had trouble and never left the ground. We didn't know that. Well, the second plane flew over Brittany, and they kept flying around, but there was supposed to be a spy in there to alert us, but he didn't show up. So that plane came back to England. So we come up in the third plane. We had 2 lieutenants and 9 enlisted men. I was the radio man. And so, and incidentally, in the plane, they put us in a British plane that we had never been in before. In the American plane, you jump out the side door. In the British plane, you sit down and slide along and jump through a hole in the floor. Well, in this plane, they said you stand up and you run along and then you jump through the hole. So I said to the guy, one thing I said to one of the Air Corps guys there, I said, you know, what's your rank? He says, tech sergeant. He said, what's yours? I said, I'm a corporal. He said, what are you? I said, I'm a radio operator. He said, so am I. Well, anyway, I said, can you hit your head when you jump? You know, you hit on the other side. And he said, oh, no. Sure enough, I hit my head. Well, of course, I was never athletic. I was always sort of bookish and spent more time in the library. So, sure enough, I hit my head, which flipped me over. So when the chute opened, I'm hanging upside down in the parachute. Well, you got all this equipment on you. You know, you got the pistol and you got code books and you got cigarettes and canteen and a first aid kit and a knife. We had two knives. We had a pocket knife and another trench knife. And we had a pistol, I think I said, and you know, all this kind of stuff. And it's all, if I got tangled in any of that, I would have been in trouble. But luckily, I managed to somersault back through it, and we landed there. And so finally, we realized there was only 11 of us in the bridge. So we said, well, we'll just have to go over and keep an eye on the bridge. Well, with that second plane flying around so long and our plane flying around, we kept flying without a signal. And then some guy lit a cigarette on the ground, so we jumped. And so the Germans thought there was a lot of us, a lot of planes. They didn't know there was only two and one left. So they didn't come near us. So we held the bridge for a few days. And then we went into the town, Landivisio in Brittany. And then we stayed there a while. We got together with the underground there, the French. And then along, after a while, we went out on a few little raids on little towns around there to clear out the Germans. We captured a lot of Germans and guns. And then when the army came through, I think it was 8th Division, came up. And so we met the general and asked him what we should do. So he said, well, we said, we'll help you take Brest. Well, it took him 35 days and a lot of fighting. But so he said, well, you guys work with your French and you know, pick up any Germans you can running loose in these little towns around here, which we did. So then finally we went back to England and we stayed there a while. So then they said, do you want to go to China? So most of us, I like these guys, you know, most of them, if you said jump into the emperor's garden in Japan, they'd say, well, when do we start? So some of them were a little dumb, I think, too, but that goes with it, I guess. Yeah, but they were nice. Yeah, we had an awful lot of, well, we had a lot of French Canadians that lived in New England, and outside your specialists, because your specialists were the medics and the radio men. So then we said, okay, we'll go to China. So in the meantime, at the Congressional Country Club, months earlier, General Donovan had inspected us. You know, General Donovan was from Buffalo. He was quite a man. And so when we came back to the Congressional Country Club from England, he threw a party for us. Oh, a real nice party, a dinner, and they had girls there and drinks and entertainment and dinner. It was real nice. So then they gave us a 30-day furlough. So then most of us went to China. They put us on a train and we went to Camp Anza outside of Los Angeles. And from there we got on a boat and the boat went to Australia. And we docked there for 2 days. Well, we've been on the boat about 2 weeks, but they wouldn't let us off the boat. And we could look down on the shore there and there's all these guys running in and out of saloons and that, women running around, but they didn't want to let us off. They figured maybe you'd never get back on. So then the boat went on to Bombay, and then we got on a train and we went over to Calcutta, and then we got on some of the oldest trains in the world. They're even older than the ones in Africa. And they took us up to Assam, Well, our captain, Cook, he was quite an eager beaver, so he says, unless, without flying into China, let's take some trucks in over the Lido Road, you know, the old Burma Road. It's really the new Lido Still Road, which left from Lido in India. So we got these Canadian trucks, and we were carrying ammunition and towing some howitzers. And you go up and down these mountains, you know, some of the highest mountains in the world, and it's a pretty crude road. A lot of trucks went off the edge, and there's no guards or anything. It took us 13 days. It was 1,097 miles. We went through Burma and into Kunming. We went over a bridge. I think it was the Wanting. It was by Wanting, the Salween, I think it was. And they had a big sign up, 10-ton limit. They had some Chinese soldiers there. Well, in the meantime, our truck had broken down, so we're being towed by a... So we had 27 tons. So we said, well, we can't go back to India. We're going forward. We didn't think they'd shoot us, which they didn't. So we're going up and down over this bridge, you know. Finally, we made it into China. So we got to Kunming, and I never forget when we delivered the trucks. One of the officers there said, now you guys can wash the trucks. So we put up an awful row, you know. We thought, well, we're combat troops. We don't wash trucks. And then we just brought these trucks in for 13 days. So they finally let us out of that. So then the idea was, well, China was a mess. I think they might have been better off on the other side for us. And Chiang Kai-shek was a crook. And they were all crooks. Incidentally, they were going to set up commandos, 150 Chinamen in each commando, and there was to be 20 commandos. Well, they said they were going to give us the cream of the Chinese army. Well, we used to say to each other, this is the cream, you know, we wondered about the rest of it. I found out way later, and you know, the Chinese were, a lot of them, but they were all crooked. So the first five commandos were picked troops, but after that, they sent in any old coolies they had for the next 15. So we were training them in the rifles, and we had, you know, 150 Chinese to a commando, as we called them, and we were to you know, work with the Chinese and the raids and that. So we trained for a while, and they also sent me again to some radio school there in China, and then. The war was ending, and they only managed, we didn't know it, but they only managed to get five commandos into combat. They sent in the first and second. The first one in first. And then they were going to send in a big group, the 8th, 9th, and 10th commandos. And I was assigned as radio man to the 10th. And most of the Americans who were in that had been in Burma instead of France. But they put me in there, and I was the only one that had been in France. And at first, they were rather unfriendly, but thinking Burma had been tougher or something. So anyway, the 8th, 9th, and 10th, we flew in. From Kunming, we flew to, actually, we were going to the Tanchuk Airport. We didn't land there. We had to land further away and walk in. I know we had some boats, too. But, you know, in 44, the Chinese said, you know, and Chenault and those guys, they said, build these airfields and we'll bomb Japan out of the war from China. That was one of the plans at one time, but it changed. So they built 15 airfields, and the Chinese were supposed to protect them. So the Japanese got annoyed, and they captured 14 of them, which eliminated that. Well, our job was to take those back. So there was one at Tanchuk, so... with the 8th, 9th, and 10th Commando, we attacked the airfield, and we captured it after a lot of fighting. And actually, the Chinese, we let the Chinese do more of the fighting, but we did some. And there was a lot of foul-up, too. The one commando, we put one commando down on the river, and we said, now, if these Chinese try to, or Japanese try to sneak down the river, you open up on these Japanese. Well, a couple boatloads of civilians come down, women and children. So these Chinese open up on the women and children, they shoot them all. And we're trying to stop them, you know, cut it out. We said, so we had an inquiry later, and they said, well, we thought they were Japanese. And we said, well, you know, the Japanese wouldn't have women and children with them. They said, well, they were collaborators. They were working with the Japanese. And then they fired a mortar and dropped it in their own machine gun nest. And a few other little errors like that. They weren't, some of them were real brave and hard working. It amazed me, but a lot of them, I don't know, they weren't that good. But so then after we took Tantuck, well, right after that, then they dropped the bomb and the war was ending. So shortly after that, well, in the meantime, they'd given me the wings of the Chinese paratroops. I think I got the 11th officer's wings in the Chinese Nationalist paratroops. They were in there, I think. So I had, there wasn't too many of us got the wings of the American, British, and Chinese paratroops. So then they took us back to Kunming, and then they flew us to India, and Karachi. We got a boat, and they took us home, sent us back to the Congressional Country Club, and we were discharged.
Now, what happened to you after the war?
Well, I went back to college. I had started my master's degree in history, and I went a year, and I didn't quite finish it. I was 40 to 41. So in 45 or 46 then, I went back for a half year, and they said they'd give me my master's if I went back from February to June, which I did. So I got my master's, and then I got a job teaching in Buffalo that September, and I just became a school teacher. Oh, I joined the reserves when we were at camp. We were discharged at Camp Meade, Maryland, and when they asked people to join the reserves, you know, most of the time they got sworn at. But 90% of our guys jumped to join the reserves. So I joined the reserves, and then I was assigned to the 98th Division Infantry, and they made me a second lieutenant. And then when the Korean War come along, I was still in the reserves. I was in from 45 to 54. But then they said I was too old in grade for combat, so they didn't call me, luckily. And in 54, I got out of the reserves. And I continued teaching until I retired.
Where did you teach?
I taught in Buffalo for about 7 years, and I went to Kenmore. It's in the suburb just north of Buffalo. I taught there for till I retired.
What have you been doing since you retired?
Well, my wife is blind, and I didn't bring her with me. She's got a lot of problems, but I didn't think she could walk that well. But she got involved in a lot of, after her kids were grown, she got involved in a lot of blind activities with volunteer work for the blind, and I did a lot of that.
And you had children?
Yeah, we adopted 3 children.
Any grandchildren now?
Yeah, I got 5 grandchildren, 8 great-grandchildren.
Great.
Yeah, oh, they're great. They're all, they all are.
Great-great-grandchildren.
Yeah, 8 great-grandchildren.
Wow. Still interested in history?
Oh, yeah, I read a lot. I've just been reading one of Tom Brokaw's books. I read a lot of history, especially on World War II.
Good. Let me come back and ask you a couple of questions.
Sure.
You said you were an isolationist.
Originally, yeah.
Yeah. Did you belong to any of the organizations?
No. In 39 and 40, I started reading. Well, I read all the time, but I read all these horror books of World War I, Barbusse and Siegfried Sassoon and Remarque and all those guys. And mm-hmm. You read all the horrors of the First World War, you know. So I thought we should stay out of it, although I wasn't in favor of Hitler or anything. But no, I didn't join anything. We did have a big meeting at UB, and we had some speeches in that before the war, but that's all. And then after the war, then I changed my mind.
Now, you said you had a 3A deferment?
Yeah.
What was that?
I was supporting, well, I managed to get enough jobs and time where I was supporting my mother and my sister. And then when my sister got married, by that time I was ready to go.
Well, what were you doing at Curtis Aircraft?
I was a riveter. First I was an inspector and then I was a riveter.
And what kind of planes were you riveting?
Oh, P-40s and C-46s.
Mm-hmm. How long were you doing that?
I was there about a year.
What was it like working for Curtis in those days?
Well, it wasn't bad, except they put me on nights. At first I was on days, but I had that 4:30 to 1 shift, and I didn't like that at all. But it wasn't so bad. But at first, I had a job as an inspector for a while, and I had nothing to do. I had about 20 minutes work a day, but you couldn't sit down, you couldn't talk to anyone, you couldn't read. You just had to stand there for 8 hours.
Can you remember any special activities at Curtis or in Buffalo regarding the war, you know, like war bond rallies or pep drives or scrap drives? You know, what was life like?
Well, I guess that was it, but I don't remember much about it. One thing I remember that got me when I was home on furlough, I read in the paper they had a blood drive. They were short of blood. So I went, I'll go down the next day. So I went down to get blood. Well, there were three of us showed up. There was a Navy officer and some civilian, a woman, and she came in and she was drunk. she turned around and left. She wouldn't give blood. So just the two of us. I said, boy, there's not a lot of blood coming from the home front.
But now you were you went to Fort Niagara briefly?
Yeah.
What was that like?
Well, that was interesting. Let's see. And Thursday morning, we met at the museum in Buffalo, and they put us on buses and took us over to Fort Niagara. They ran us through a lot of stuff on Friday and Saturday morning, and then we were through from Saturday noon on, and Monday they shipped us out.
Now, your initial training for OSS, let me see if I got this right now. You were in the Marines in the officer training program.
Yeah.
But then they told you to go home.
Yeah, right.
And then you were drafted into the Air Corps.
Yeah, right.
Trained in radio telegraphy.
Right.
And then somebody asked for volunteers.
Right.
Which is kind of interesting because, you know, OSS was always looking for academics, and you're from Buffalo, but the way you get into OSS is by being asked to volunteer out of an Air Force school. Was the Congressional Country Club the first training you took in the OSS?
Yeah.
And
That was about 3 weeks.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, the Tommy guns.
What kind of other people were you dealing with? What were the other trainees like? Where did they come from?
Well, as I said, in our group, we had a lot of French Canadians. And many of them had been in the original paratroops, and they came from the regular paratroops into ours because they could speak French.
What kind of training did they give you at?
Well, a lot of it was, well, we would run around in the dark, and there was map work and Tommy guns, knife fighting. With Major Fairbairn, you had to run through the woods there and stab trees and stuff like that. He was quite a character.
Learn how to use the Fairbairn knife.
Yeah, yeah. And they had a special building at Area B where you had to run through with your pistol and your knife, you know, and things would fall out at you. And, you know, in fact, of course, as I said, I was never very athletic. I was rather clumsy. And the lieutenant told me when I run through with my pistol, he said, "You're going to kill yourself."
Did they ever send you off post on any of those simulated raids, Rock Creek Park, or you know, go against a civilian target and see if you can get in?
No, they did in England though once. I sort of wonder if that was sort of phony. We sneaked up on some stuff in England and we got in too easily, I think. I wonder.
Anything else you can recall about your OSS training?
It was interesting, and there were a lot of characters in there. I mentioned Colonel Obolensky. There's a lot I've read about. I met Captain Chapel a couple times. There's been some reunions. I've seen Captain Chapel. There was a whole book written about him, and he was originally in a German group, and they didn't use it, so he went into Italy, and he fought in North Italy with the Italian partisans.
What about some of the other European officers? Dulles or any of the other?
I never met any of them, no. I just met, OG, what we call. There was about 25,000 people in OSS, maybe 20 to 25,000. A lot of them did paperwork or library work or stuff like that. And now a few, then some were getting their uniforms ready, and the paymasters are making sure you got all the stuff so you can pass and as a spy in Europe. But they had this a group in Burma, in North Burma, Detachment 101. They did a lot of fighting in North Burma and using the natives there, and gave the Japanese a lot of trouble.
Now, well, how was your training different from the country club to Camp David? What was different about Camp David?
Well, it was a lot more weapons, heavier weapons, more weapons.
Did they teach you anything about incendiary devices?
Oh, it's explosive, yeah. Yeah, we were always blowing trees down. In fact, we had several guys blow their hands off. We had a lot of accidents. I was lucky, I guess, because I wasn't that,
What kind of radio equipment did they give you to operate?
We had the little radios. Incidentally, when I jumped in, that was another thing. When I jumped in France, I had the radio receiver. But they put the, for some reason, they had four transmitters. They put them on the first two planes. So when we landed in France, I didn't have any transmitter. I only had the receiver. And so I couldn't send any messages back to London. And then I found out way later, too, every night I was tuning my receiver in, but they had changed the call letters in London, and they never told us. So we didn't have any contact with London at all while we were in France.
When you were dropped to secure the bridge from a route to Brest, did you hook up with the Marquis then? Or?
Yeah, there was a lot of underground running around. Yeah, they were real nice, except they weren't trained, and they had a tendency to make a lot of noise and shoot at nothing a lot, but they were good.
And how long was it before American Army was able to relieve it?
It wasn't long. Well, we were about 3 days, I think, they came through.
Did you ever get the feeling the Army didn't know what to do with you, being that you were OSS instead of military?
No, I don't know.
This wasn't what they called a Jedburgh operation, was it?
There were Jed. I've heard of the Jedburghs, but we
your
weren't.
Team was.
We were called OGs.
OG
operational groups. They said they had a few people in Indochina at the end of the war. And they had contacts with Ho Chi Minh. General Donovan was quite a man.
We'll talk about that in a minute, but I got a couple other questions. Were you ever issued the L capsule? You ever hear those? They ever give you a capsule in case you were going to be captured?
No. General Donovan had one. He was on the beach in Normandy, on D-Day.
Tell me about General Donovan. How did you form this opinion that he was quite a man?
Well, I had heard about him, and, he seemed friendly, He would didn't come up and pat you on the back, that, but he seemed approachable. I spoke to him, told him I was from Buffalo, and I read a lot about him. Mm-hmm. And he had quite a career. He got the Medal of Honor in World War I. One day he was his aide was Joyce Kilmer, who was killed next to him.
Yep.
And the next day his new aide was killed next to him, and he was badly wounded. And he was the highest decorated soldier or officer in World War I of the Americans. He was quite a guy. And I got a letter today from the OSS Society. There was all kinds of, there were a lot of bigwigs in there. Of course, some of them were probably phonies, I don't know. There was some criticism in that, but it didn't apply to us, I don't think, none of us. And, but, they formed a society, and we've had some reunions. I was at one in Cincinnati a few months ago, and a lot of these men, they worship Donovan. You can see that. They have these dinners and all that. I get these letters, of course, but I can't fly to New York City for a $75 dinner or lunch.
Do you ever feel sort of a pride or, empathy with Donovan because you were from Buffalo and he was from Buffalo?
Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah.
Local boys make good?
Yeah.
The command, how many men in a Chinese commando?
150.
And were these the units they called the Jing Paw Rangers, or was that a different command?
No, never heard of that. Right.
And while you were in China, did you ever run across another OSS officer, John Birch?
No, I heard him later. But no. I heard of him later.
Well,
General Wiedemeyer inspected us once.
Uh-huh. And what impressions did you form of General Wiedemeyer?
Well, I don't know. He just came. We were just training these Chinamen and firing. These Chinamen, they it was sort of hard to teach them. We had with the old three rifle, which is a good rifle. And one time they had a little path in back of the pits there, and some civilians came down, and they all our Chinese opened up on them. Say, live target. We had to try to squelch them from killing the other Chinamen.
Well, if you had it all over again, who would you rather fight alongside of, the Maquis or the Chinese commandos?
Well, I don't know. They were both, I think the French.
So, after all these years, looking back, what stands out the most when you think of your time in the OSS?
It amazes me that I ever jumped once.
Did you ever hear any of those nicknames for the OSS? Or
Oh, So Social.
Oh, So Social.
Yeah.
What was that about?
I don't know. Maybe there's some people got in like that. And, of course, Donovan was a big New York City lawyer. He had a lot of contacts with people, and so a lot of them joined up now. I don't know, as I said, there were 20 to 25,000 in there, and only 1,000 in the OGs, in the SOs. There's probably maybe a couple thousand combat people. But of course, in any group, it's about one-tenth of combat.
We're running out close down to the end of the tape. If you could just hold that up so we can see it in the camera.
Yeah.
And if you could just point out the different objects.
Well, this is a Chinese flag we had with us to let the Chinese civilians know in case they ran into us that we were to be helped. This is Special Forces. That was one of our badges. Mm-hmm. And this is the British paratroops. Right. You wore that on your left chest. This is Chinese paratroops that we had. I was a sergeant at the end. And this is the Chinese wings. Here's the American wings. This is some Nazi thing I picked up somewhere. And this is Schaeff, the Supreme Headquarters. At one time they said we were connected to Schaeff, indirectly. This is the 98th Division,
right.
And I was in the reserves. And then here's my ribbon. Here's an arrowhead and a battle star for ETO, and then two battle stars for the Pacific Theater. And then this is the Victory Medal, I think.
Well, any last thoughts? Anything else you'd like to add?
Well, it was very interesting. I'd do it again. I think it was very, very interesting. Of course, I'm glad I got through it all right. But
yeah, we are too. I don't know if you know.